is, and you can make the diagnosis if you know what you're looking at. And then you can generate a report and basically move on. By at like dermoscopy, using confocal microscopy, also there are now tons of papers that RCM imaging basically can reduce the benign number of benign lesions you'll remove to get to a malignant lesion, and that's published. And this can really, obviously, this scope is expensive right now, but at some point it is going to become affordable for most of the countries. But given the estimated global incidence rate of 4.6 million new cases of skin cancer every year, the potential savings can be on the order of 10 million biopsies per year, meaning in my clinics at least, like every time we look at a lesion, we used to biopsy previously. We are not biopsying because most of the time, 90% of the lesion, most people biopsy, at least for nevi, they come back benign. So we don't biopsy them anymore. We actually use this confocal microscopy. And now, so the question is, because this obviously is non-invasive and you're not cutting and you're not staining, how good is your diagnostic accuracy or how good is the diagnosis? So there is literature on it that by using on melanocytic lesion in previous papers, they have gotten up to 70-96% sensitivity and about up to 88% specificity. We published this paper, I think, last month in Archives of Pathology, where our sensitivity and specificity was very high of 98% and 99%. But like any other doctor, any other dermatologist, any other pathologist, you're only good with experience. So I've been using this technology for over 10 years. So by now, I understand what lesion should look like, but if it's a beginner, obviously the sensitivity, specificity won't be this high. Now, not only that we can diagnose tumors or neoplasm using confocal microscopy, we can actually look at inflammations and infections also. And we actually had this cute paper in Journal of Cutaneous Pathology last a month, where we basically picked a scabies mite using confocal. Obviously, you don't need a scopy or anything to diagnose scabies, because in Rawalpindi General Hospital, where I did my house job, we used to see 30 to 40 scabies a day, so you don't need any technology, but it's nice to see with confocal the mite sitting there in stratum corneum. And so confocal now, we're also using it like to make these bedside diagnosis. So it is, in summary, then it's quick, non-invasive, and painless method for diagnosis. You can avoid unnecessary biopsies. And now it is used in, other than skin tumors, we are also using it in skin diseases like inflammatory skin conditions. So the limitations, so every technology, every new invention always have limitation. The limitation of this technology are, it's the images are in black and white, like X-rays. And initially it takes time to understand where is the nucleus, where is the cytoplasm, what we're looking at. And then also, sometimes it is difficult to separate Langerhans cells from melanocytes because they both look dendritic. And also the cytology, like in histology, we can tell an eosinophil from a plasma cell, from mast cell, from lymphocyte, but in confocal, those cells are not very well easily separatable. Another limitation is like the depth, the maximum depth the confocal can see at a good resolution is up to 300 micron, that means up to reticular dermis. So if you're dealing with panniculitis, or if you're dealing with some lipoma, or if you're dealing with things which are a little bit deeper, then you may not be able to see. And sometimes, depending on the location, it may be difficult to use it. So these are the limitations. Now, I'll give you examples of how we in my department are we are in my practices we're using to make bedside diagnosis with RCM or confocal microscopy. So this is one of our cases. So this is actually a common scenario. It happens all the time because The question here is this a lentigo or is this a flat seborrheic keratosis, or if it's a lentigo maligna. So now, I'm a pathologist also, a dermatologist also. If I take a 2 millimeter biopsy or a needle shape biopsy from middle or the edge of the specimen and I send it to a pathologist, he or she is going to tell me, give me the whole lesion, otherwise I can make the diagnosis. But I can't remove this whole lesion because it may not be malignant. So in those cases, really, confocal or other non-invasive tools in future will become important. In this case, we were with confocal, easily say that it is a lentigo, this loops with the rings. This is a classic pattern of lentiginous hyperplasia on confocal microscopy. So in this case, obviously, we were able to save him a big scar. Next case is a 64-year-old female with a lesion on left cheek that was previously biopsied and it came back just chronic eczema. After 6 months, the lesion persisted and physical examination found still a 2 millimeter fibrotic papule. So all these difficult cases on the face where my friend dermatologists don't want to biopsy, they send it to me, get me in difficulty. But I put a confocal and you see within this red circle, I can see this beautiful cauliflower-like lobular hyperplasia, which is good for some kind of basal cell or a little bit dysmorphia from basal cell because it's deeper. So in this case, then again, I was able to tell my dermatologist friend, go back and remove it because it is a basal cell, which on superficial biopsy, he didn't see. Case number three, a 21-year-old woman presents with a red-brown patch and red-brown patches and plaques on anterior thighs. And clinically, it could be eczema, it could be psoriasis, it could be many other things or just post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation. Here is I put a confocal microscope on it and I see this white, irregular looking round cells way up in the stratum in Malpighian layer or epidermis. So this is so-called poultry abscesses of mycosis fungoides. So I'm not saying you can diagnose every mycosis fungoides with confocal scope, but in this case I was able to capture it and we later on did confirm it was mycosis fungoid or CTCF. So these were three examples of using confocal microscopy just on bedside. But obviously we also use it because I also am a confocalist, so I get cases from all around and I sign them, which is just doing like a tele confocal microscopy. Now, the use of confocal microscopy and many of these non-invasive technologies will really alter the way we monitor treatment monitoring. Right now, what is our choice? Let's say we do we use a new cream or a laser for removing a wrinkle. Now, what is our choice? Like to see how it got better or how it was improving during the treatment in between, you can't do biopsies. Nobody wants biopsies on the face just for a laser treatment or for a microneedling or for a new retinoid or for any other treatment, psoriasis or something. So it is easier for clinical trials, for understanding of the disease, for lives of the lesion, if we can see during the treatment how the tissue is changing. So here we are running this trial on acne scars using some laser resurfacing or Fraxel laser, but then we are following that with confocal microscopy. So if the patient agrees, we can actually look at these scars every week without cutting. On the right, I'm showing confocal, and we progressively we can show as the scar heals and the collagen reforms where we are. So it just makes the treatment more objective. Here, this is an interesting picture. These are Demodex mites on the top on A and B. There are a lot of those mites in the hair follicle at the bottom. After the treatment, the mites have died or disintegrated into small pieces, and now you can't see them much. So this is, obviously, you don't need to use confocal microscopy again to treat rosacea, but it's a fun way to look at it that the treatment is working or it's objective. Similarly, third case, I have psoriasis here. This is my patient who was on one of the biologics, secukinumab or Cosyntex. And before the treatment, it has papillomatosis and those capillary loops and neutrophils on the left side. On the right side, this is normal skin. As the psoriasis heals and the lesion become flatter, you see the capillary loop with these rings, they become more prominent. So I know the treatment is, in this case, objectively, I can see how psoriasis was improved. So changing the gears a little bit, so we talked about confocal microscopy, we talked about dermoscopy, few words about telepathology. So basically telepathology, like telemedicine, mean that the person who's reading the slides is somewhere else, or teaching the slide is somewhere else, and person who want to be taught or want to be educated are sitting at a separate site. So the traditional way is you buy an expensive scanner, and then there's a software, and then you can basically share these slides with anybody you want. But a more economical or a cheaper way, which we are now implementing in Rawalpindi Medical College with Dr. Kadus Bhatt, I hope he's here or he's listening, where basically all you need is a microscope with a video camera on the scope, which can actually be, it's not very expensive. You can get an easy one with like $300 or so, and then you just need internet. So once you have your scope, your a video camera or a digital camera and internet, then you can basically sign your cases. Even if you don't have a dermatopathologist, you can have lectures from across the world, or you can give lecture to the other people. So all you need is a simple scope, a camera on it, and internet, and then you share your screen using commercially available services such as WebEx or other services, and you can teach and telepathology between two groups. This is one of our scope in another country, and my students and me sitting in medical school are basically teaching or learning from each other. Telepathology I'm not going to teach tonight because it's a long subject, but I have my own way of approaching skin inflammations, and basically I divide them into epidermal, dermal, subcutaneous, and then depending where they're located, then that's my classification. And this is just to show how I approach it. Again, this is not a time or the morning to go through skin pathology, but basically using telepathology and already set module, you can learn, teach, or educate each other quickly. Now, the last segment of the lecture, I'm gonna go into evidence-based medicine or evidence-based therapeutic updates. Obviously, we can't cover all dermatology, but some topics of interest to you and me, we will talk about that. So basically we will be using this model. The model is the evidence. How do you discover something is evidence based? Basically, there are established criteria by British Journal of Dermatology, by Archives of Dermatology or Archives of Medicine, or many other associations have done so. So if you want to say, let's say a gluten is bad for atopic dermatitis, and then there is a study published, and then they conclude based on their study that gluten is good or bad. But what happens is gluten is actually a good example because it can be involved, but there are other things which usually are not that significant. But more